Hello everyone, welcome to the first lecture of Everything We See. And today we will, so it's a 6 lecture series, and today we will cover the modeling of economics of fund carry, waterfall, and how to create a cap table. So all these things are very basic day-to-day what an analyst does in his job. So we thought of making into a series of lectures and have some instructors to teach these to us. And so for today's lecture, we have Ritesh Banglani from Stellaris. He'll join us in 10-15 minutes. And Anand Lunia, he's a partner at Quotient. Me and I'll begin with the session. Just one rule, I request you to please keep yourself at mute. And if anybody has question, we'll keep it interactive. You can use a raise hand feature and then you can ask your questions. So that way we can pick up questions throughout the session, but totally depends on the instructor.
Perfect.
So over to you, Anand.
Okay, guys, super. So we are going to do this assignment, okay, till Ritesh comes. What I'll do is I'll just explain the assignment to you. This is a company which has got a seed or series A term sheet. I think this is looking more like a Series A term sheet in the new world now. So they have a term sheet with an offer of $1.5 million for 15% equity from one investor. In the same deal, suddenly they have another investor interested who wants to, who's open to, in the same term sheet, join at a premium of 25%. The founder is like reluctant to dilute, but finally agrees to more money. And both the investors say that, okay, we want equal equity. The second investor said, I'm willing to pay more money, but I want equal equity. And investor one says, I will not increase the pre-money. The pre-money has to be what it was earlier. Right. So this is the broad deal structure. Both of these people want ESOP post-money at 10%. So you have to build for that. There's also an existing investor in the company who owns 10% of the company. And apart from the 10%, has a convertible of $250,000 US. This 250K will convert at 25% discount to investor one. So you have three prices here. Pricing for existing investor, pricing for investor one, and pricing for investor two. Right? So what I want you to do is to draw the cap table for this company in terms of percentages. That's what you want to do. Okay? So this is the exercise. Make assumptions wherever necessary. You can start doing it right now and ask me questions if you get stuck. And if anybody sort of has done this, knows the method, please feel free to contribute right now. Okay. Did I make sense here?
I think yes, the question is complex, but it's clear.
Okay. Can I ask comments from, I see this name, Samarth Gupta. Samarth Gupta, are you here? Hey, can you?
Hello. Yeah.
Yes, Samarth, yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Samarth.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the question right now. So,
okay.
No increase in pre-money. They want post money ESOP at 10%. What does that exactly mean? Like,
meaning at the end of the whole cap table, there should be a 10% ESOP.
Okay. Okay. Right. Fine. Yeah. Interesting. Okay.
So how will you go about this?
Let's see. I'll go by investor wise, what exact terms they want. And for investor one, term sheet of 1.5 million for 15 million at a 25% premium. So he investor two comes in. So that's in terms of valuation, it will be he'll be valuing it higher, or does that mean he's giving a higher valuation from the 1.5 million?
A higher valuation, yes, and higher money.
Okay,
higher amount, because they both have equal equity, right?
Okay, so equal equity, but for 25% more than 1.5, so.
So anybody
1.8.
Right. Anybody who wants to contribute to this, I mean, any ideas? How do you start? What will your first step in a spreadsheet? The simple thing is to start with a spreadsheet, right? open the spreadsheet and start putting something. What do you put first? Anybody else?
Is the pre-money valuation.
Sorry? Yeah, you find out the pre-money valuation. What is it?
8.5
million. Everybody agrees with it, right?
8.5.
Okay, 8.5. Right? So now, how do you go about making the spreadsheet for this? Shashank. Okay, I can hear somebody else. Who is this? Everybody's on mute.
Yeah, sorry. So basically, hello. So sorry, I couldn't hear the last part. Am I supposed to speak or am I supposed to put myself on mute?
Tell us how you start your spreadsheet or if you want to share your screen.
Yeah, so just one second. So I'm on my mobile. I don't have a spreadsheet, but I can tell you what my thought here is. So investor one. So investor one has a 8.5 million pre-money, and he doesn't want it to change. Right now, we have three large constraints. So we know that there's an existing investor who will convert to a 25% discount to investor one. So we have these two valuation set, which is for the existing investor and for the two new incoming investors. So essentially for both investor one and the two new investors, we can find the pre-money valuation in terms of just the variables that we need to take. We can take the same equity percentage for both investor two and investor one. So if we are making, say, a column, so we can make a four column spreadsheet.
You are on the phone, right?
Yes, I'm on the phone.
Can I ask somebody to volunteer their spreadsheet, share the screen? I see somebody here. Mohit, you have any suggestions?
Who should? I had a 15 minutes head start, so I was able to solve it. So I don't want to skew the discussion.
I also don't want to show a screen if it is wrong.
So first thing while I was solving it, so I had to assume.
I can try sharing my screen in front of me.
Okay, I see new names here. Harsh Gupta, do you want to speak? Can you share your screen? If you have a spreadsheet, anybody has a spreadsheet ready, can you raise your hand? Anybody can just show the screen to us of the spreadsheet.
I'm still working, but I think I have a model that could work on this.
Sure. Go ahead. Yeah, just show. No? We just want to see the work in progress. Even a blank spreadsheet is good. Just show something.
It says I cannot share while somebody is sharing.
That privilege is with Mohit. Mohit, can you help?
Anand, I think you have to stop your share and then he can.
Okay. Okay. So Chirag, what you are doing is you are straight away putting pre-money, right?
Yeah, so this was for when investor one wanted to came in with 1.5 million.
Mm-hmm.
So that would have been a 15% dilution with 8.5 pre. Now for investor two, it's a 25% premium. I'm assuming it's on the pre-money. We know he also wants 15% equity.
Okay.
So the question is how much does he need to invest, right? So this will be like a goal seek is how I'm thinking about it. So essentially, what I want to do is I want to match the equity to 15%.
You have taken dilution at 15%, right? But we are holding the pre-money the same. The equity for both the investors will go down. It will not be 15%. Chira. Okay, anybody else? Chira, think about it.
Yeah.
The equity will go down for both.
Yeah.
Right? So it may not be 15% each.
I think we should first start with setting up the finding number of shares. So we can assume some number of shares and then.
I think guys, is try to find out the share price first. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the way this works is that whatever is the share price for pre-money of 8.5 million, right? So you assume that before the new investor came in, there are 10,000 shares in the company. Okay, at the pre-money stage. And these 10,000 shares are worth, okay, yeah, you want the question back? Let me do that. All right. Guys, maybe you want to take a screen grab of the question. Screen grab works, right? Okay. Anybody else who has taken assume the number of shares, like 10,000 shares, and then started working on that? Anybody else want to share the spreadsheet? Anubhav Goyal.
Hi, Anand. Yeah, just working on it. Give me a minute.
I'll stop sharing, sir. Current Tichindani. Okay, let me pause it on him. Current?
Oh. Yeah. Why are we assuming pre-money to be 8.5? Because if two investors are coming in and both are going to get 15%, and if he's investing 1.5 million.
Pre-money is headed by the first line.
Right.
8.5. And the first investor is saying that will remain same. Whatever money you add is fine, but the pre-money has to remain the same.
Right. But in case, if we just assume that both investor one and investor two are going to get 15% each, with a $10 million.
No. Who said that? They are going to get equal equity. They are not going to get 15% each.
Okay. So it's going to get diluted down to equal equity. Okay.
Yeah. Equal equity. Exactly. Guys, I mean, a simple term sheet, though, simple spreadsheet, you guys know how to make, right? So this is a complex one. We are throwing you in the pool straight away. Sorry for that. We are throwing you at the deep end of the pool, I think. Okay, I will try somebody else. I see a Sonam Sahni. Do you want to share your sheet?
Sir, I'm still working on it.
Okay. Can you show what you're working on?
Yes.
Something ready. I just want to see your spreadsheet, that's all.
But I'm still trying to figure out.
Okay, no problem. Take your time. Okay, Ishan Rakshit. Ishan, hey man.
Hey Anand.
Batao kya kiya Ishan?
Nahi, I've just joined. I just took a screen grab and looking at it. Sorry about that.
Okay. I see. Okay, we have a Vineet Chaudhary sitting right next to you. Vineet, okay, Mohit, you want to show?
I can show.
So let's not share the answer, right? We don't want to share the answer.
So first of all, I have assumed this number of shares to be 10,000. So this will go step by step. So first, since we know the pre-money valuation, using that as a base, we have to solve for the angel investor, then for his discount, then we will solve for the ESOP pool, and then comes investor one and investor two. So we cannot directly solve for investor one and investor two. So this was my without any investment cap table, where I have assumed two promoters equally at 50% holding. Then came the angel investor at 10%. Now the company is raising Series A, and we know that it has raised a bridge round of 250K from the angel investor at 25% discount. So this is something there in the problem statement. Given the investment is happening at 8.5 million pre-money, so we will calculate the pre-money for that angel investor. So this 6.37 is the pre-money valuation for the angel investor, and we'll get the share price from this. So the share price will remain same.
Okay. Thanks, Mohit. Guys, anybody who sort of still doesn't get a direction? Please raise your hand. Okay, can we go back to the people who spoke earlier? Anubhav, what do you think now? Chirag? Chirag Gandhi?
Yeah, Anand, just trying to recalibrate thinking with share.
You like this approach from Mohit?
Yeah, I think this is pretty interesting because share price becomes the common denominator across.
Absolutely, and share price will be same pre-money, post-money, it'll be the same, right?
Yeah.
The share price will remain constant. It will not change just because you added gone from pre to post. So you simply need to find the three share prices. Price one is for angel investor, existing investor. Price two is for investor one. Price three is for investor two. Once you find out these three prices, you simply have to add number of shares to make this whole spreadsheet work. Yeah, and in the end, you will have to still adjust for ESOP.
Yeah, so there's a catch with ESOP. So in general, you have to solve for ESOPs, otherwise your share price will not come correct.
You need to insert ESOP. So guys, all of you are working from home. Take your time to do the spreadsheet. We don't want to give the solution. My partner Madhukar privately is telling me that this will not happen to anyone. So I don't think so. It's not very difficult. Mail us whatever you've done. Mail us why you got stuck. Ideally, we don't want to mail the solution to anybody. Right? It will Mohit will help you separately to arrive at the answer. But this thing is better done yourself. Ishan, kya lag raha hai?
Karan is raising hand.
Ishan, kya lag raha hai? I'll come to Karan also.
I like this approach. I'm just trying to apply the same. Using the share price as a denominator is obviously the best way right now.
Okay. Chalo. Theek hai guys, let me upload the PPT because okay. What we'll do is, so guys, please spend your time, right? Feel free to talk to each other. But whenever you are done, mail a spreadsheet to Mohit. Mail or Mohit, you want to get it uploaded somewhere?
I don't have any portal right now, so mail will probably receive in the mail.
You can, or we can discuss in the WhatsApp group as well.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay.
Shared my email address.
Okay, don't post 60 files in the WhatsApp group. That's all. Okay. Okay, guys. You've seen the topics, right? Do you guys want us to add any more topics to this? If you missed something? Everybody okay with the topics?
Yeah, I think looks good for the start.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Cool. Okay. Just to get an idea, how many of you know the legalities of a term sheet and know the legal agreements and all? We're not covering all of that in detail here. I'm assuming all of you know it very well, right?
Yeah.
Okay. How many of you have read this, like any book or detailed article on venture capital? Any books you read on how venture capital works? Any blogs you follow?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What blogs do you follow?
A16Z.
Yeah. That's a blog about technology, future of world, and you know all of that, right? I mean, A16Z probably has done more harm to us than benefit, right? Because they kept saying the software eats the world, but then all the software eats the world, the investments have gone bad. Right? If you look at Uber, or delivery, whatever, wherever software was eating the world, the valuation has gone down and the burns are very, very high. So, but what do you read about in generally deal making? Like how do you negotiate a deal? How do you do MIS? Anybody who reads Jason Lemkin's blog?
No.
You guys should look at Jason Lemkin's blog. You should look at some of the blogs which talk about metrics. How to individually dive deep into markets, dive deep into companies. Semil Shah has very good blogs. Christopher Jans has very good blogs. So maybe Mohit, what we should do is probably circulate a list of good blogs to read.
Sure, I'll prepare one and.
Yeah, I'll help you prepare one. So it'll be good if because it's important that we read more deeper stuff and not just top level technology trend stuff. Yeah, Gagan is giving some suggestion on Christopher Jans' Sand Hill Road book. Yeah, Sand Hill Road is a good book. Venture Deal is a good book. Suggestion by Akshita.
Right, Venture Deal,
it's a good book. Yeah, I mean, too detailed for my taste, but still a good book. Okay, guys. We are waiting for Ritesh to come. Mohit, you want to show your spreadsheet? You have something ready?
Sure. No, I'm not ready. Just working on that. I've matured to another step. Just
make some progress?
Yes.
Show us.
So, till now, I've reached a point where I have calculated the number of shares that would be allotted to the existing angel investor. Because of that 25% discount. So beforehand I was able to calculate the
share. Change, Mohit, the number may change eventually, but we'll see.
We'll
have to insert ESOP here.
No, so ESOP will come after this. Okay. So now till now, this is the cap table. Hmm. Which is calculated. Now, after this step, I will first calculate an ESOP, which will be higher than 10%. And just to account the dilution of the two investors that would be there.
Right.
And so till now,
this 250K, which is already in the company, is that added on top of the 8.5 million pre-money or is that included inside the 8.5 million pre-money?
So I have not used that 250. I have so what I have decided is there is a 25% discount on the pre-money for the investor one. So I have simply this 8.5 million pre-money. I have just done a 25% discount and I arrive a new pre-money valuation of 6.5.
So I think people will mail the assignment to us. Ritesh, what we were doing is we were doing this. Sharing this exercise for designing a cap table. People will mail it to us.
Excellent.
This is just a cap table exercise. We just discussed the exercise. We didn't go into the solution. Just a home assignment.
No, please carry on if you need to, Anand.
No, we are done. Mohit was actually trying to solve it, but I was reluctant to get it solved. We were waiting for you.
Excellent.
Anand, over to Ritesh now.
Hey everyone, I'm really sorry for being late. This is Ritesh Banglani. Let this be the first lesson of the training, to be honest, that you prioritize portfolio calls over everything else. So, sorry, one hygiene question. Anand, Mohit, is everyone muted and who does the control lie with?
So it lies with you also. I made you the co-host for the session. So not everyone is muted, but if you want, I can mute everybody and remove that access to unmute. Or we can just request people to keep themselves on mute and use raise hand feature whenever they want to speak. That can also be done.
Yeah, that actually works better. Everyone can be on mute to begin with. And please do speak up. Just don't speak over each other. I would love to have a more interactive session rather than a one-way communication. Great. So let me start by introducing myself. My name is Ritesh Banglani. I'm a partner at Stellaris Venture Partners. I have been a VC since 2007. So in March, in fact, completed 13 years in the industry. I was expecting it to be a lucky 13, but look what happened in March. I started my career as a senior associate and became a partner with a venture fund, Helion, and then started my own venture fund about 4 years ago, that is Stellaris Venture Partners. Because of my experience, I do feel qualified to talk about what not to do. I don't think anyone in our industry is qualified to tell you what to do. But I guess if between Anand, Priyank, Madhukar, myself, if we are able to tell you or give you a few words of caution on the mistakes that we have made, I think that itself will be quite a big achievement. I do want to start with a couple of assumptions that I have made about this group. Please do speak up and let me know if those are not true. I'm assuming that all of you are currently employed with venture capital funds. I'm also assuming that you are relatively early in your venture careers and that your overall level of experience is less than 5 years at this point. I'm not making the assumption that all of you want to pursue venture careers in the long run, but I am assuming that all of you are interested in technology and startups. If anyone does not have that profile, please do let me know.
Can you guys hear me? Hi, Ritesh. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Please, Kelly.
Hi Ritesh, my name is Shubhro. I used to work for a venture fund. I used to work for Kalari Capital. I work with a strategic investment team at Udaan.com right now. So yeah, slight departure from.
Got it. Anyone else who's not at a venture fund or does not fit the profile that I shared?
Shortlisted accordingly. So I think there were like 150 people who were interested. We shortlisted people who fit the profile you mentioned.
Got it. Great. So let me, I've prepared a few slides. I would love for it to be, like I said, an interactive discussion. Sorry, one more question. Is there anyone who has been in the industry for 3 years or more?
Yeah, close to 3 years.
Yeah.
Okay, because the material that I've prepared is really basic to begin with, more to give an idea about what you have just joined, just how a venture firm functions. So my apologies to you and to anyone else who already knows all of this. So let me share my screen. Hold on, let me also close my WhatsApp. Okay. Can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Great. So this is really, I wanted to start with a primer on venture capital, a little bit about what a venture capital career is like, how funds are structured, how funds economics work, who are LPs, and what is every party's motivation. So maybe in the interest of keeping it interactive, I do want to start with a question. We can take this question from three or four of you as to why you joined venture capital. And I'll fill in this answer as we go along. So as long as you're not speaking over each other, please unmute yourselves and tell me why you joined venture capital.
So for me, like I have been entrepreneur and this seems to be the step ahead in my career. That's why I joined, obviously.
Okay, so close to entrepreneurship as a career. Okay, and you, I'm sorry, please do introduce yourself as well because I can't see who's talking.
Hi, my name is Apurva. I also work with India Quotient. For me, I think I joined because it gives me a chance to regularly interact with new startups and be updated with the current technology trends, and every day is a new day, so it's exciting.
Got it. So you mentioned two different things: keep up with technology trends and spend time with entrepreneurs. Anyone else?
Hey Ritesh, this is Rahul.
My name is Ryan.
Go ahead, please.
Go ahead, Rahul.
Rahul, please go ahead.
I'm sorry, I just joined late, so not really sure, but I have a fairly large amount of work ex, and I'm neither an analyst or an associate, but was very intrigued to learn here. And I also don't work on the term sheet side of things. So I have a fairly very different role. But quickly to give background, ran a company for 7 years, sold it off, failed one, and was literally tired and wanted to see that how do I actually help other entrepreneurs. And that's why I got a role in a VC.
Got it. Thank you so much, Rahul. So I'll put help entrepreneurs as a as the motivation,
coupled with after making money, losing money, I was looking for something comfortable, to be very, very upfront and honest. Yes,
very interesting. Comfortable job. Okay.
Hi, my name is Ryan. So I think VC or an investment management industry
is not a comfortable. Sorry, I have to have the laugh on this comfortable job thing. So.
Well, those who've been entrepreneurs, they would always say VC is a far more comfortable job. But
Ryan, carry on.
Yes. So I think a VC career promises a very handsome returns, and I think that's the VCP investing is a career where you get rewarded 20% of your carry share if done well, and also handsome AUM fees. That's one. Second thing is you are the first one to know what the trends are, and that gives you in a different position.
Got it. So I think Apurva already mentioned keep up with tech trends, but this is an interesting one. Ryan, one question for you: when you say high reward, what do you think about the level of risk that enables you to get this high reward?
I'm looking at it from an investment manager point of view, and a career in investment management in VC. Yes, the level of risk is high, and I'm looking at it from the AUM fees point of view and the fund economics, as well as the carry. The LP is ready to share 20% of the profits if you do well. And I don't think any other industry there will be ready to part away with such kind of returns for whatever contributions we make.
Got it. Great. Any other reasons people join the VC career?
Yeah. Hi. So I'm Shashank. So I've worked with two different VCs in different types of VCs as well. So I think there were three reasons why I joined. One is just the proximity to people, both on the founder side as well as on the venture capital side. So it's a fairly small closed ecosystem. So you get to interact with both kinds of people and high caliber on promoter as well as on investor side. So that's number one. Second is for any future role, whether it's in directly as a starting up or perhaps in the founding team of a particular company, it gives a good aspect, good perspective on what and how we can build basic frameworks of building a business specifically from zero to one. So I think primarily these two things, and third is that just from an early professional perspective, there are barely a few industries where you would get this sort of ownership and independence to do things that that are at the intersection of technology and future trends. Just on the point of VC getting high rewards and handsome returns, having been part of two different entities, I understand how difficult it is to give those returns and to get that 20% share, specifically in an India setting in the current state. So it's not an easy role for sure, especially for the general partners.
Got it. Thank you so much for empathizing with general partners. Anyone else has any reasons beyond the ones that are already listed on the slide?
So Ritesh, hi, Anand. So I work with Ritesh at Stellaris. My main reason was that I wanted to become an entrepreneur. I want to start at some point in time and wanted to follow up that first approach of how the ecosystem works, how if you were to go about starting from scratch, what would be the optimal way to do it. So cut from the first go. So probably hoping to learn a bit of that here from the second round.
So I couldn't hear you very well, Anand, but the part that I heard, I'll put down here, which is learn how to be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Great. Fantastic. So let me tell you my story as well as to why I became a VC. I took this decision roughly at the stage of career that you guys are at, maybe a little bit later. I was, 28 or 29 when I decided to enter the VC industry. At that time, I was working at a startup, and I would see these young venture capitalists who were roughly my age, who would come into the board meeting. I used to report to the founder of my company. This was a company called July Systems. And I used to see these people, come into the board meeting, ask very intelligent questions. They used to come dressed in suits as well. I used to be quite enamored of these people. I used to once in a while be called into the board meeting to present something to the board. And I used to think these are smart people who my boss kowtows to. The power equation was very clear. My 40-year-old boss used to look up to these 28-year-old VC associates. And I said, maybe I could be that. So to be honest, when I started my venture career, I was enamored by the glamour of venture capital. I didn't put that much thought into it as you guys have. It was also a slightly different time and a slightly different awareness level. But if I'm being completely honest, it was the glamour value that attracted me to venture capital. And I'm also, I can also say equally confidently that within 3 months, the glamour value disappeared entirely. When I realized that the job is not about wearing suits and going to board meetings, the job is a lot different from what I had imagined. So do want to give a little bit of a reality check of what a venture capital job is like and and what are the pitfalls as well. For me, and actually for a lot of people who have been entrepreneurs and operators, perhaps the biggest frustration of a venture capital job is that you are not in the driver's seat. If you've been an entrepreneur especially, you are used to being in the driver's seat. You're used to doing things yourself. Here, you are at best an influencer. At best, you can suggest to someone what to do, but you cannot actually do it yourself. And for a lot of operators, that ends up being incredibly frustrating. The other thing that I have noticed in my career, which actually gets, even today it gets me down, is that this is a job in which you fail about 80% of the time. I have made a few good investments over the past 13 years. I can probably count on the fingers of one hand the good companies or the successful companies that I've invested in. Everything else has been by and large a failure. And it is very, very hard for otherwise successful people to deal with the constant failure in this particular job. It also sometimes makes you negative. So 5 years into my venture career, I had at least a existential moment where I was like, I have spent 5 years of my life on this. What do I have to show for it? And it was, I would say maybe at that point, 5-6 failures and one somewhat middling company, not even a success at that point. And that does tend to grind you down. You also tend to realize that that you are much more affected. Your career, your success is affected by randomness to a much, much greater degree than in other jobs. In most other jobs, there is a relatively decent correlation between effort and outcome. But in venture capital, that correlation pretty much disappears. I can very confidently say that I have put the most amount of effort into companies that returned absolutely $0 to us. And that's not, it's not only for lack of your effort, it's also randomness is introduced by market forces, randomness is introduced by what's happening today. Even today, I can confidently say that perfectly healthy companies, perfectly good companies will die in the next 6 months because of a completely random event like the coronavirus. Now, if you are working in Goldman Sachs, with my apologies to Anag, the effect of that that event is attenuated to a much, much higher degree than it is in venture capital. So you just feel exposed. This also means that you're not sure whether you're doing well or not, because even if you have had a few successes, you tend to attribute those successes to luck more than anything else. The other element that I used to and still get extremely frustrated by is the lack of a feedback loop, or the fact that the feedback loop is extremely long, minimum 5 years. Those of you who are in the first 2-3 years of your venture careers will not get real feedback till you are in the fifth or the sixth year of your venture careers. You probably do get feedback from your colleagues, you get feedback from entrepreneurs, but that is not real feedback because they are also making a judgment on how good you are and how good your judgment is and how good your processes are. You don't get market feedback. Let's say you are an entrepreneur who's developing a tech product. You get feedback very, very quickly. Literally, if you are developing an app, let's say you push out a release, within a week, the numbers will tell you whether the release or that feature worked or not. Here, that feedback loop is 5 years, 6 years, or longer. And that can be incredibly frustrating. One thing I did not anticipate, even sort of midway through my venture career so far, was that even when the success happens, it is not that large. I had invested in a company called Taxi for Sure, which got sold for $200 million, which was actually in the Indian ecosystem, it was a very large exit. The founders made each in the range of roughly $50 million. What came to me personally was a tiny, tiny amount. I could have made that money in salary in about a year, roughly. And that made me realize that even when success does happen, the translation to, I mean, someone earlier mentioned, if I may just go back, of handsome returns and high reward. Given the fact that the pie gets divided very significantly, first 80% goes to the LPs, and that too, we'll talk about how the pie gets divided a little bit later. But suffice it to say that when the reward actually comes, it is relatively small. Someone mentioned, I think, that they are from an investment banking background. You compare the rewards with, let's say, 3 months of effort in investment banking to 7 years of effort on an investment in venture capital, plus the risk that you take, it is the rewards are not that material always, unless you have an outsized success. Which is my next point, that this is a business of extremely delayed gratification. I saw my first carry check in my 10th year as a venture capitalist. I had joined in 2007. It was not till I had not seen any cash till 2017. The cash in 2017 came from an investment that was made in 2008. You know, since then there have been a couple more checks that have come in. But one, there has been extremely delayed gratification. Second, you could argue that relative to the risk that you take, the rewards might not be that material. And definitely compared to your peers, those of you who are in the first couple of years, if you compare with your other equally smart and equally ambitious peers, who will, how your returns will look like, how your income will look like over the next 10 years, I can guarantee you that compared to your peers, you will make less money over the next 10 years. Another thing that people don't always anticipate is the level of risk in venture capital. Someone mentioned it's a comfortable job. You're right, it's comfortable in terms of the number of hours worked, but it is far from comfortable in terms of the level of risk that you take. In venture capital, you don't necessarily take a huge amount of financial risk. The GPs do take significant financial risk, but as an employee, I did not take significant financial risk when I joined venture capital. But I did take a huge amount of career risk that I think I did not know about at the time that I joined venture capital. The world is littered with former VCs. That has started to happen in India as well. I'm sure you all know people who are former VCs. And if you don't get lucky in your first 5 to 7 years of your job, you are pretty much unemployable elsewhere. You spend 7 years in venture capital. Just to give you my personal example, when I left my last operating role, the iPhone had not been launched yet. So, you know, imagine I was a product manager, and if I were to look for an operating job as a product manager today, I would have no clue where to begin, because the world has changed. The paradigms in which I was used to being a product manager no longer apply. So I think people in venture capital severely underestimate their employability risk. So I would argue that venture capital is not an easy career. It's extremely frustrating. It is extremely random. And financially, the expected value of your earnings is probably significantly lower than for many, many other careers. Still, people do end up joining venture capital firms. Before I get to why, what are the upsides that I have seen, I'll pause and take any questions on these points that you might have.
Hi, Ritesh, this is Mridul. Could you elaborate a bit more on the feedback loop? What specifically did you mean in regards to feedback? And what is it that you would love to get feedback on, and how you said that the timeline for it is really long? A contrasting point would be if I have been part of a deal which did not do well and has been shut in the let's say in a couple of years since the investment. That's a strong feedback that I've gotten and learnings that I can take from that. But what was your point regarding this?
Sure. So my point was that because 80% of a firm's investments result in failure, you don't actually get to know earlier in your career whether you're a good VC or not. You need to have made a sizable number of investments or been a part of sizable number of investments to know how good your judgment is. Because let's say your first three investments fail, that doesn't tell you that you're a bad investor or you have poor judgment. If your first 10 investments all fail, then you can reasonably conclude that there was something about your judgment that was probably not, either you got exceptionally unlucky or you're not a good investor. But to make 10 investments, an average person would take 5 years. And you don't, for an individual investment, I would argue that you don't get any feedback for 2 to 3 years on how good that investment is. So for the last year's investment to complete that process is a 7-year cycle. So you don't actually know, you don't collect enough data on whether you are a good investor or not for 5 to 7 years is my point.
Got it. Thank you.
By which point, like I said, you are unemployable. So my mentor and my ex-boss at Helion was Ashish Gupta. When I had gone to him for a job in venture capital, he discouraged me to the extent that I'm discouraging you. And he said that you are getting onto a bus that is headed into a wall. You are not driving and the driver is blindfolded. That is the level of risk that a venture capital career entails. That many, many of us, including myself for sure, do not anticipate. Any other questions on this?
Yeah, hi Ritesh, Siddhant here, Kalari. So I want to ask a question on the last point, right? Which is, where's the money, honey, right? Is this because it's a very Indian specific thing? Because if you look at globally, obviously, because they've built product companies where distribution was at a global scale, or where people's willingness to pay software was far higher than our market, is a function of the money not being there in venture, because we really don't have truly digital products that have emerged in our ecosystem? Is it a function of us being still very nascent? What do you think it's a function of? Because clearly, definitely, with so many smart people getting into venture in the West, there is money to be made, right? It's not whole. It's not as bad as we think it is, at least back here.
So, Siddhant, based on what you have asked, I would actually say that you are probably well suited for venture capital, because an irrational optimism is probably a prerequisite for being a venture capitalist. So my point was not so much about India versus the West. Later on in the session, I will talk about how much money can a venture capital fund make and the probability of doing so. My point was relatively more straightforward, which is that compared to the level of risk, it's not, I'm not saying that there's no money. I think the salaries that VCs make are decent. They are not necessarily the top salaries, but they're decent. They'll give you a comfortable lifestyle, but they'll not make you rich. And the probability, if you take a risk-adjusted expected value of your income, it would actually be very, very low, because the probability that the fund will make money and you'll have enough stake in the fund when it does make money, you multiply both of those, it becomes small. And the risk that you take, I would argue that an entrepreneur today doesn't take the level of career risk that an individual venture capitalist takes. Those of you who were entrepreneurs, I'm assuming that your ventures were not spectacular successes. You were able to find a very coveted job, I'm assuming relatively easily. I'm calling VC a coveted job. Whereas an unemployed, whereas a VC who has been an employee and hasn't done well, remains unemployed for a much, much longer time. And when he or she does get the next job, those are, I would say, bottom of the barrel jobs, and not top tier roles. So I would argue that a failed VC finds it much harder to get his or her career back on track than a failed entrepreneur does. Someone had raised a hand. Please ask the question.
Hey Ritesh, this is Varun from Mentera. Great insights. But the whole point of being unemployable, making bad investments, is slightly ironical, because every fund has like a 5-year deployment cycle, but there is pressure to deploy in 3 or 4 years, which increases your risk of making bad investments so that the fund can raise a fund 2, fund 3, fund 4, and the cycle can keep going. So do you think as a GPE, it is also a GPE's responsibility to slightly limit that pressure of early deployment and raising further funds, or so that there are less blowouts in the portfolio and more better investments?
So, sorry, Vishal, right?
Varun.
Yeah. Varun, this is a little tangential to our discussion, so I'll answer relatively briefly without giving too much logic. I think if a fund has difficulty deploying in its investment period, that means the fund size was not appropriate for the strategy. And it is the fiduciary responsibility of the fund manager to then return the capital that they have not been able to deploy back to the LPs. And I don't think it is, and even if the reasons are external, I think if a venture capitalist engages in the behavior that you are outlining, which is reckless deployment just because you have to finish putting all the money to work, I think that is a clear breach of fiduciary responsibility that I would not advocate. Moving on, I don't want to be entirely negative, because after all, I have stuck with this career for 13 years now, and I do wish all of you the best in this career as well. So I want to talk about, if there is a venture, this is the first time I've used the glamour wore off in a few months' time. Here I am 13 years later, still in the same industry. So there must have been something that kept me here. I think the number one thing for me, actually I have a few bullet points. I do want to talk about and those of you who have been in this industry for a couple of years would understand the cadence of this industry. In a startup, in any operating role, the cadence is constant action. You are literally, if you have not been productive for, if you have not achieved anything for a week, you start questioning yourself, or your boss starts questioning you, or your colleagues start questioning you. In venture capital, early in my venture career, 1 or 2 years into my venture career, I met one of the partners at Greylock Ventures. He had been in India for 2 years and he had not done a single deal in those 2 years. So I asked him, I think Srini was his name. I asked him, Srini, what are you doing in India? You have been here for 2 years. You haven't done a single deal. Don't you think you're wasting your time? And he says, think of how much money I have saved for my fund in the past 2 years. So the cadence in a venture capital deal, a venture capital career, as you all know, is like keep meeting companies, a lot of relatively, I would say, low stakes work, keep meeting companies, keep reading, keep learning, reject everything, then go to the next day, do the exact same thing. Five entrepreneurs the next day, five entrepreneurs the next day after that, five entrepreneurs after that. Two or three times a year, you have a spike when you do a deal. Maybe five or six times a year, you go close to doing a deal, so there's a spike in action. Out of those that you spend a lot of time with, maybe you do 30-40%. An average investor ends up doing, I would say, 2-3 deals a year. So you need to be comfortable with that level of productivity. You need to be, people, I find that entrepreneurs in particular tend to have a very high need to be productive every week, very high need to measure your output every week, every month. And a VC career doesn't offer that. So a venture personality, to me, needs to be comfortable with the sporadic nature of the action. Coupled with that is actually the reason why at least I have stuck with venture capital for the longest time, which is that even if nothing is happening, even if you're not actually doing deals, which you are not most weeks of the year, you need to find the reward in learning itself. To me, this is an amazing career where people come to your office, seek time on your calendar to come and teach you about their businesses. So this is like being in a constant learning mode. And if you are curious and if you do enjoy learning about various businesses, learning about the world really, I think there is no better career where people come and teach you about healthcare in the morning and fintech in the afternoon. So if you do derive joy from learning itself, it is actually an extremely rewarding career. An important criterion almost to me to be a VC is not having the urge to fix something that is broken yourself. You need to be able to leave it to someone else to break it. You note down what is broken. And then you wait for 3 years till the right team comes along that wants to fix what is broken, which is very different from how entrepreneurs operate. In my experience, the best entrepreneurs have the almost a pathological urge to fix something that is broken. I am insulting all of you and myself by saying that VCs, to be a good VC, I think you need to have a type 2 personality. To not have, I think people who have a high need for credit, a high need for limelight, and a high need to be the center of attention actually make very poor VCs. They end up interfering in the startups that they have invested in. They end up being prima donnas. And I think especially over a long venture career, the more subdued your personality is as far as seeking credit, seeking limelight is concerned, I think the better VC you'd be. Almost counter to this, and this is where I think this is why it is very, very hard to find balanced VCs, is that you need to balance that type 2 personality with a love for people. I don't need to belabor this point too much, but if you are going to spend all of your time with entrepreneurs, you better like spending time with people. If you can't, or if it drains you, then the day-to-day life of a VC will likely be very draining for you. All of what I have mentioned before points to an extreme amount of patience that is a requirement for a VC career. If you are comparing yourself with your peers, people that you went to college with, on how far they have gone in their careers versus you, it is likely to result in heartburn. So both a nebulous definition of success and a patience to wait for it, I think, are almost prerequisites. And lastly, like I mentioned, there is a high likelihood that you spend 7 years, the 7 years that I spoke about, or the 10 years that it takes to generate even your first carry check. If money matters a lot to you, then you might not have the patience, or you might end up being extremely disillusioned at the end of that 7 or 10 year period if you haven't gotten there. So I do think that, and this is not judgment, this is for each of us to actually evaluate for ourselves, how much money matters to us. If it does, to the extent that it is one of the top three important things in our lives, and I don't mean money to lead a decent lifestyle, I mean money to get rich, then I would argue that we are better off doing something which is higher beta than a venture capital career. Venture capital is not actually that high beta, and so the rewards relative to the risk are not very high. So in a nutshell, stay for the intellectual stimulation, stay for the energizing, the energy that being with entrepreneurs gives you, stay for the underlying learning, stay for the inherent joy of eventually having helped create something which is huge, but not for credit or fame or money or productivity even. That's broadly the lessons I have learned in my personal career as venture capitalist.
Ritesh, Priyank here. I just wanted to add one last point to this. Zero venture personality. I think I agree with, hi guys, I'm Priyank, I'm a partner at Axel. One big thing which I've learned, and that probably was not part of my journey initially when I was an associate, and I learned really when you start doing your own investments, you know, you need to have what I called a killer personality or a cognitive load of pulling the trigger and saying, I will invest in this company, and taking you know, that puts a lot of strain and stress, at least for me, when I make an investment decision, am I doing the right thing? So you need to be sure of yourself. You need to be very confident of yourself. A lot of, I've seen in this business, there are different kind of investors who also seek out, especially when you're junior, am I doing the right thing from senior partners or partners? And that you need to become very independent, essentially, I think, which is not covered in this list probably. But that has to be conviction. What is your conviction? And you have to hone that skill significantly with patience. Yeah.
Excellent point, Priyank. And that too, conviction with very little data. So it's like playing poker, to be honest. Thankfully, with mostly other people's money. Anand, Priyank, I didn't realize you were there. Anand, Madhukar, if you guys are there, anything to add? Okay, I'll move on. So let's start with who our customer is in a venture capital fund. You see a rather smiling picture of Anand on top. And there is, everybody knows the flow of capital. The LP gives money to the fund manager to deploy, and the fund manager gives money to the founder. This, by the way, is Farid, founder of ShareChat. So this tends to convey an impression that the customer is the LP. For several years into my venture capital career, I used to believe that my customer is the LP, that my LP pays me, and that my primary responsibility is to ensure that to create shareholder returns. Over time, I have realized that the primary flow of capital in venture capital is not this LP to the fund and fund to the founder. The primary flow of capital is the reverse one, where the founder generates value and gives money back to the LP. So the ultimate driver of success in venture capital is actually the value creator, who is the founder. And the value creator is always the customer, in my mind. So venture capital exists in order to serve the entrepreneur and not the other way around. And I believe that as long as we do the right thing by the founder, of course, by selecting the right founder, but also then by enabling the founder to create that success, the shareholder being happy will always be a byproduct of the customer seeking you. One thing I also realized relatively late in my venture career, which a lot of people don't seem to appreciate, is that venture capital is a network effects business. I have always wondered, especially early in my career, how come funds like Sequoia and Axel and Benchmark keep delivering hits 1 year after the next, after the next. Sequoia has been around since, I think, the 1970s, and they have been one of the best performing venture capital funds globally for that long a period of time. The best answer I had early in my career was that they are successful, so they have the ability to hire the best people, and those people then select the best companies that create success. But in reality, I think that this is a career, this is an industry where success leads to success. If you are able to create one very large success, that does two things. One, that completes this cycle of the founders returning money to the LP, eventually means that you are, the LP gives you more money to invest. Second, it means that you, once you are associated with that success, the next set of founders come to you in preference to other VCs, because you are permanently associated with success. So Priyank's fund, Axel in India, is associated with Flipkart to the degree that I would argue that there are very few founders in the country who go to any VC that have not gone to an Axel or a Sequoia or some of the other large and successful funds in the country. In order to create that virtuous cycle, in order for both of these network effects, the network effect of capital, that success means you get more capital to deploy, and in terms of brand, that success means that more high quality entrepreneurs come to you. In order to kickstart both of those network effects, you need to first do right by the founder, which is why it is now my tightly held belief that the LP is merely a shareholder. The actual customer is the founder. And if you can create customer value, shareholder value will always follow. Any questions, disagreements, comments on that? Okay. endowments, foundations, and pension funds. These are usually based in Western countries. The US is the largest contributor to these. What differentiates them? I'll put sovereign funds in the same bucket. Sovereign funds are the country's sovereign capital. So let's take the UAE sovereign fund, or Saudi sovereign fund, or Sweden sovereign fund. What is unique about both of these sources of capital is that it is primary capital. They are not deploying someone else's money. They are deploying money that they themselves own. So let's take a university endowment. The endowment is owned by the university. They are not deploying someone else's money. Everybody else, the corporates are deploying their shareholder money, shareholders' money, fund of funds are deploying their clients' money. Of course, when we come to family offices and HNIs, again, it becomes primary, but the size is not very large. This makes the fact that they're deploying their own money actually makes them very long-term and patient investors, which is extremely useful in venture capital because it's a long-term asset class. They are not answerable to anybody else outside the organization to manage that money, which is why they can take long-term calls, they can take riskier calls, and they can stay with a venture fund manager through ups and downs. The next category is corporates. Corporates, the one salient fact about corporates as LPs is that they are often driven by their strategic agenda. That corporates don't always invest. In fact, in most cases, they don't invest for pure returns because their shareholders have given them money to invest in their business. Their shareholders have not given them money to invest startups in India, let's say. So unless there is a high alignment with their strategic agenda, if the startups, for example, if the startups are that you invest in add value to them as LPs, they get first look at those startups, they get to see what's happening in what innovations are happening in their industries and so on. They are unlikely to be interested because their job is not to manage their shareholders' money. Their job is to invest the shareholders' money in their businesses. Fund of funds are another unique animal. These are people who take their shareholders, who take capital from primary sources and say, you are not specialists in venture capital investments, for example. We will make venture capital investments on your behalf. Which does make them very astute at making VC investments. But there are other challenges. One, they have their own fee structures. So their bar for return becomes higher because they have to justify their own fees as well in the middle, as well as their own carry. And the second salient point about them is that they are driven by their own fundraising cycles because they don't have the money doesn't belong to them, it belongs to their clients. So they have to, every 2-3 years, they have to go replenish their coffers as much as VC firms have to. And so the level of uncertainty that raising from a fund of funds carries is a lot higher than raising from primary capital owners like endowments and foundations. The last couple of categories are again holders of primary capital, family offices, and high net worth individuals. They have their own capital, they make their own decisions, but they are not always very professional in making these decisions. And sometimes may be swayed by emotion, swayed by FOMO, swayed by what their peers are doing, as opposed to making purely objective decisions the way some of the others in this list do make. So these are the usual sources of capital for venture capital funds. Would love to answer any questions and would love to hear any comments from Anand, Priyank, Madhukar, if he's there.
No, it is being very good. I think people have to understand that this money is sort of really public money in terms of nature of the money, and it is a reasonably very highly managed money which has very high returns expectations actually, right? So it is not that this is sort of dumb money and you know we get lucky. Raising venture capital is very complex. The most complex thing here is that while a startup just needs one investor per term sheet, in raising a fund, you probably need 10, 20 investors, maybe even more sometimes to get put a fund together. And you can't really just take three LPs and get a fund ready. Right? So you have to sell to multiple people and who are all like really, really very, very clinical about their process, very bureaucratic, you know, very slow to act. So it's a, yeah.
Absolutely. It's like herding cats.
Herding cats.
Nobody will invest unless everyone else also invests.
Absolutely. So it's like, you know, you have to create a FOMO and hope that, you know, the while the FOMO is going on, nobody backs out.
Absolutely. Prayank, anything from your side?
Yeah, I think the one thing I will add is like everybody said, I don't know how most of the analysts don't understand the way VCs work in capital calls. So I just want to touch on that a little bit and how LPs play a part of that. So when somebody says they've raised a $100-500 million fund, it's not that the entire money comes into the bank account same day. They basically have commitments from LPs to get that money. Now a fund and most of the LPs for them, the way they will, and as you start doing investments in the fund, every quarter or every couple of months, you basically go to the LPs and say, I have done $30 million of investments in this quarter, for example, and please give me the money. Now, what can happen? Majority of the times you get that money. But for example, in a situation like this, where we are, public markets are falling, LPs, the way they would give their money typically would have been, they will sell somewhere and then give that liquidity to you to increase the IRR further. Now, there are scenarios where some LPs can come and say, this is not going to happen. You know, we don't have money to give you. So even though you might have given term sheets out and now you go to LPs and say, I need $10 million, you might be able to get only $5 million because a couple of LPs might back off. So that is a real possibility. And somebody had raised the point that in US, there are so many smart people working over there. There is an industry you will see actually next year, how many VC funds go out of business. And in these scenarios, typically the very, very small funds typically tend to get, no disrespect to anyone, but that is where the problem is, simply because of the fact that, the LPs typically would not be long-term players.
Yeah, Prayank, I agree with you. I think our own fund right now is facing some of these problems. And like Ritesh, in this fund, I mean, I've had some carry in my previous funds, but in this fund, we are yet to see a rupee of carry. It's been more than 7 years. And we are, much before we saw any money, we are already like facing these problems of LPs sort of, you know, like asking us to delay the drawdown, et cetera, et cetera.
On that cheerful note, let's move to the next slide.
I think Ritesh, one thing. I think it's sort of we are creating too much of gloom right now.
No, I'll come to the good part very quickly.
Come to the good part.
So I do want to buttress a little bit of Anand's point. This is an actual. I do want to share how LPs invest their money. This is an actual asset allocation from the Swedish sovereign fund that manages Sweden's sovereign money. This is their asset allocation. As you can see, they've invested 19% in Swedish equities, 39% in global equities. They are committed by law to keep 32% in fixed income to generate interest for the government's expenditure. And 7% in real estate. All of alternative assets put together is 2% of their allocation. I went and looked at their annual report, took the graph on alternative assets. These alternative assets include PE funds, some high yield fixed income funds, esoteric assets like private jets, oil fields. This includes all of that. So the actual allocation to venture capital funds out of these will be in a 0.1% range. Now, the other thing that you see here, one is, of course, how little is invested in alternate assets in general and venture capital in particular. But you'd also see the huge fluctuation in the returns from alternative assets. I point you to the last line here, that alternative assets, they're of course externally managed in the sense that they give this money to fund managers to manage. Last year, they returned 11.5%. This year, they returned 3.4%. This variability in returns is in fact why the asset allocation to alternative assets is so low. And this is the risk that I was talking about for our LPs. Now, in this kind of a scenario, and for all the reasons that Priyank and Anand also mentioned, fundraising for VCs is very, very hard. I do want to talk about what matters to LPs. On what basis do LPs take decisions? I'll not run you through everything, but of course, probably the number one thing is the team and the track record that the team has generated so far. This is actually why it is very, very hard for new VCs to raise money. Whether you have the network and the background to be able to wisely invest that capital, whether you have support from previous portfolio founders and co-investors and so on. But very importantly, there are a lot of factors which are completely beyond your control. How does India compare to US and China as an attractive destination to invest capital in? Now, that is not something that can control or Anand can control or I can control. But that is actually, I would say, probably one of the biggest determinants of whether an investment gets made or not. Shubhro, you have raised your hand. Please go ahead.
So I have two questions. One is, in terms of process, like raising venture capital, we understand the process. I mean, it's fairly well defined. Someone like an analyst, their analyst has an application process. You go and sort of raise money. So very briefly, how does that process work? Are there processes in place, or is it a very small rarefied circle and you need to know the right people and so on and so forth? That's number one. When you are raising money as a new venture fund, that's number one. Number two is, like in venture investments, we see like a seed investment, for example, or a pre-seed investment has a very low threshold of checks. It's more on, okay, you know, this might work. Let's just give them the money. So is raising a $20 million fund easier than raising a $2 billion fund? Because like basically what are the checks and balances that differ when you're raising slightly larger capital? Do people just give away like $200,000? Okay, you know, you can take it and let's see what happens.
So Shubhro, if you give me a couple of minutes, I will answer both of these questions. In fact, I can take the answer to your first question right away, which is what I meant by prior relationships. There is no defined process. There is no defined list of LPs that you can go to. Like if you're an entrepreneur in India, you can source pretty much an Excel sheet of people that you can go to raise your seed capital or Series A capital. There is neither a defined process nor a list of LPs that is handy that you can go to. It is extremely dependent on relationships. Most institutional LPs will not invest in you for 3 to 4 years of knowing you. So you need to build those relationships over a period of time. They need to see how you operate over a period of time before they can write a check. That's probably an opportunity for some entrepreneur to make that into a process and technology, but that doesn't happen in today's world. Before I come and answer your second question, I do want to mention one important point, which is that an LP's current exposure to similar VC funds actually matters a lot. Let's say Stellaris goes to the market to raise venture capital from an LP. If they already have one, a significant exposure to India VC as an asset class, they might just say we cannot put more than X percent of our VC exposure in India. So even if you are a good fund, sorry, we are full up. Or they might say that I have, while I can invest in another venture fund in India, I already have exposure to three early stage funds in India. So in terms of my own portfolio construction, I don't want exposure to yet another seed and series A fund. I would rather look for exposure to a series B and C oriented fund. Or they might say I already have exposure to tech funds and I would now look for exposure to, late stage private equity. I would look at exposure to consumer oriented as opposed to tech oriented funds. So existing exposure to VC funds actually plays a very significant role in an LP's decision. At least it has been our experience, and I would love for Anand to weigh in on this more as well. It has been our experience that the size of the check doesn't matter to the, as far as a lower end of that check is concerned. You can't make the argument to someone, to an LP, that, okay, don't give us $10 million, give us $2 million. Because they write a very small number of checks every year. In an asset class like India VC, even the world's largest LPs will not write more than one check a year, at most. So then you cannot make it more attractive by saying the risk is less, put only $2 million or $200,000 instead of $10 million.
Ritesh, this is it's the reverse. On the contrary, most LPs prefer a fund size of a minimum few hundred million dollars, right? I mean, you would have faced that when you were raising $100 million. Most people would have told you that, you know, it's probably too small. And maybe come back when you raise $300 million. So most LPs are actually looking for bigger allocations. And the reason
that is also because of materiality.
Materiality.
You can only have a small number of relationships.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
it is same
like move the needle.
So most LPs are probably as big as SoftBank, a similar size. And for them to start writing $1 million check will be like crazy, right? I mean, how many deals will they do? So it has to be material. And typically a fund has to sort of, match what we've seen is a few hundred million dollars where somebody can put $25-30 million per deal minimum. And they don't want to take more than 10% of the VC fund. So no LP wants to come and say, you know what, I will give half of your money to you. You go and raise from 10 other people and we'll all put 5-10%, 10% each, right? And that's the math that works out. So typically, if the GPs have the right experience, raising a $300-400 million fund is relatively easier compared to raising a $50 million to $100 million fund.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The number of people who have told us come back in your fund three, exactly, when you have a larger fund, is probably more than 50%.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Most of all, and this is obvious, this is probably obvious to all of you, the number one factor that matters is cash returns that you have generated. And this is where I would say there are a handful of VCs in India, Axel being probably the biggest one, that have generated high cash returns.
Yeah, I think Axel and Westbridge, the original fund, Ritesh, the other problem here is that typically takes like 10 years to return funds. And the first wave of funds probably started in 2006-07 when you and I started our careers. So we will anyways have very few funds who will have returned cash. Right? And very few funds are there in the country just by a function of time. Next 2-3 years, we'll probably have a few more funds joining in that cash return quick mark.
Absolutely.
We are young that way as a venture ecosystem. I think in the next 3-4 years, probably many more funds, newer funds will return cash.
Absolutely, that is we live for that day.
but we should also say that all the guys, all the analysts who are on this call are very lucky because we are entering that phase. So they will hopefully find it easier than us.
Yeah. Absolutely, that's very true. Very true.
Great. Sorry, any other questions before I show you another pretty picture of Anand?
Welcome, Ritesh.
Okay, moving on. So let's talk about how VC funds make money. This is the same cash flow cycle that I showed a couple of slides ago, where the LP gives money to the... Sorry?
Nazar mat lagao.
Yeah, I used the one documented case of cash flow coming back to the LP. So this is the cash cycle, right? But how does the VC make money? You all would have heard of and surely know of the 2-20 model, which is that the fund manager makes 2% management fee. So takes 2% of the first arrow that goes from the LP to the fund, and then takes 20% of the last arrow, the returns that go from the founder to the LP. Now, this seems like a very, very sweet deal, right? That the 2% is guaranteed and the 20% is the cherry on top. And very often, this is the question that we are asked by people who join venture capital. I think this is the impression that some of you had when you mentioned on the first slide that you're looking for a comfortable job with high returns, because this the comfortable job comes from the 2% and the high returns comes from the 20%. So this looks like the best job in the world. The problem is we are forgetting one very, very important aspect, which is skin in the game. Nobody will give you money unless you are putting your own money along with your LP's money. Now, I can't speak about everyone else, but new GPs like Anand and myself are not independently wealthy. We don't have enough money to put into our funds. So we have to take money from the 2% that we receive and invest it into the companies that that we are investing in. As of today, 90% of my personal net worth has been invested into my fund. This is what I was speaking about when I said that that this is a high-risk career. It is high risk for employees because of the career risk that they have taken. But for GPs, it is high financial risk as well. If tomorrow, God forbid, coronavirus wipes out all of my fund's value, I will lose 90% of my personal net worth as well. Not just my career and not just the opportunity to do future fundraisers. And that is why for several fund cycles, I would say from when you start your first fund for at least a 10-year period, you are actually not making any money. You are not making any part of that 2%. I can't tell you the numbers, but I can tell you that my partners and I are not the highest paid people in our organization. Very much like entrepreneurs who usually take lesser salary than other CXOs and VPs in their organizations. A fund manager also has to make the same call, because after you take out the fund expenses and after you take out the money that you need to invest into the portfolio companies, you don't have enough left to take a large salary. Roughly, my partners and I are making 35 to 40% of the salaries that we used to make when we were employees in our last fund. And that is why it is high reward. I mean, we won't be doing it. We are not irrational people. we wouldn't be doing it if we did not believe that the 20% reward will come. But that you don't make anything out of the 2%, anything more than a small salary, and which means that you don't make anything till the 20% hits. And for the first 10 years of your career as a GP, you are pretty much subsidizing the fund in the hopes that you will create a large and long-lasting franchise. So all of us, Anand and myself for sure, are in this because we want to create the next Axel. We want to create that positive network effect that I spoke about. So in this sense, it is actually not significantly lower risk than entrepreneurship. If you take the extent of the skin in the game that VCs need to put in compared to entrepreneurs and combine it with the career risk that VCs take, I would even argue that being a general partner in a VC fund is actually more risky than being an entrepreneur. Any comments, Anand?
No, you're right. If I just want to tell the audience here, you know, when Madhu and I were starting, we discussed our cash flows. And those days, our first fund was very, very tiny. And Madhukar was like, dude, okay, let me get married first. That is the only way I can survive.
let me also tell you a story. Sorry, please go on.
Actually, Madhukar's wife supported him for the last 7 years. And I think she's still supporting him because our commitment go increasing, right? Every year. Every time you launch a new fund, you are actually committing more money. Madhukar, you want to say something?
Yeah. So I think I will add to what Ritesh and Anand are saying that not only the risk is high, the reward is also quite limited because it's limited to 20% only, right? So had we started a company in say 2013, and touch wood, if we would have got into the zone where we would have raised a Series C, Series D, we might have made more money by now what we are expected to make from a fund which we have
without an exit.
The thing is that the math of the waterfall is like you first repay the principal, then you repay the hurdle rate, and by the time it's so late, and you still have a risk going on because by the time you reach the end, most of your value is stuck only 2-3 deals, right? So one of the
don't steal my thunder. I have that coming in the next slide.
we were expecting an exit in March, right? And we had an offer. We discussed a secondary price and the price. And just 2 days after that, we had a lockdown. Okay, so we were literally counting how much personal money we will get in our bank account. And just 2 days after that, we had a lockdown, right? So the whole portfolio is for the fun itself.
Is there anyone from Matrix on the call here?
No,
I heard a similar story from one of the Matrix partners that pretty much money was going to hit the bank and they had all started counting their counting the personal share of their carry.
Absolutely.
Before the coronavirus hit.
Oh my God.
Ritesh, I am like a veteran in this. The same thing happened to me in 2010 as well, right? So that was 2 years into fund business. We were about to get one of our companies to IPO. There was not a very large share of the carry, but there was some carry which was supposed to come in. And this Andhra Pradesh Microfinance Act came in and everything became zero, right? So these kind of external risks will always be there.
Yeah, it also doesn't help, like Anand said, that you get paid last.
Yeah, you get paid
last.
Anyway, so let's talk about a waterfall where, frankly, there is a lot of fall, not enough water. So now the equations have reversed. It is the founder or the company, portfolio company, that is distributing the money. And I want to run you through how the waterfall actually works. So first, first the LP gets paid all their money back. So whatever, not just in that company, but in all companies put together, the money that they have invested in the fund fully gets paid back to the LPs. Then those of you who are not aware of the term, the hurdle rate of return gets paid back, which is the argument is that if I had kept this money in a relatively safe investment, I would have generated a certain return. In India, for example, you can, or you know, till 3 weeks ago, you could have generated a 10% return, for example, without taking a huge amount of risk. So LPs tell GPs that money I would have made anyway. So you shouldn't get paid till I make at least that 10% return on my investment. And that is called the hurdle rate of return. So first you pay the money back, then you make the hurdle rate of return. Then of course, the GP share of the hurdle gets paid to them after the LPs have been paid. Then the profit comes into the picture, which gets split 80-20 between the LP and the GP. So the profit to the LP and the carry to the GP get paid simultaneously. Now this looks like a very neat sum of money, but there is someone else who needs to be paid as well, which is Mr. Narendra Modi or the government. So of course, out of all of this money, the government takes a very significant share, which is very high for domestic LPs and the domestic GPs. Hey, about 29%.
I think we've also forgot to mention that on the fee we make, there also we pay 33% income tax, right?
Absolutely. We also pay full income tax on that fee.
So there's a lot of leakage because of taxes.
But so of course the government collects a very significant share from everyone, from the LP, from the GP, both on their carry and the capital gain. Just to give you a sense of how much the carry amount is, so if everything goes well and you generate a 3x fund, I would say the probability of getting a overall fund return of 3x is probably 30% or less. And in that kind of a fund, the carry that you make is 0.4x of the fund, which is 20% of the profit. 20% of 2x is 0.4x. So if you do make it, it's actually a neat sum of money. I would, I don't want to, I definitely don't want to say that that's a small amount of money. For someone like us, that money will come to about $40 million. If we do get to a 3x fund and that capital can be, that carry can then be shared between the team members. But if you multiply that with both the probability of that happening and the time window that it takes to get to that money, also please do appreciate the fact that the longer it takes, the more the uncertainty. The guy who gets paid first has kept their money in for, let's say, 6 years or 7 years. If the GP makes money in the 9th and the 10th year, they are taking roughly 1.5 times the timing risk that the LP is taking on an average. So the risk is high, but yes, if you do make a successful, if you make a very large multi-bagger investment, the carry can be very substantial as well. Even, and you know, let me actually quantify the carry in terms of you know, for employees, the salary that I made in my first job as an as a VC, for which I have gotten some carry, I would so far have gotten roughly, I would say, 4x my then average salary as carry. And I was, like I mentioned At that point, I was an associate, then got promoted to VP. Compared to my average salary at that point, the total money that I have made is, I would say 4x, maybe even 5x of that salary. Of course, it came after 10 years, but it is a very substantial amount of money compared to, and remember, that's something that I worked on for a period of 3 years, 10 years ago. So given the fact that it was for a relatively small amount of effort put in 10 years ago, it is actually quite substantial. But I would say a lot of it has been down to luck as well, because you are not able to influence the outcome as much as the founder is. So anyway, that is how the waterfall in a VC fund works. Just a couple more slides, please bear with me. So let's talk about the fund structure, and I have this extremely simple fund structure in mind, which is in fact the Stellaris fund structure. We will simplify it.
It's a little too simple.
And talk about only two entities here. The fund and the fund manager. This is just to give you a very brief overview of what a fund structure actually looks like. So let's talk about the fund first. Indian funds, many of you are employed by Indian funds. The fund structure in India is called the Alternate Investment Fund entity, also called AIF. This is regulated by, these entities are regulated by SEBI, so they are not free for all. You can't actually set up a fund without approval from the regulator, and you have to report to the regulator on a quarterly basis. The minimum amount of money an LP can invest in an Indian AIF is 1 crore. The minimum amount of money that the GPs have to invest is 5 crores, although most credible funds have to do several times that amount of money into the fund, which does actually create a barrier to entry in venture capital funds. You are expected to invest primarily in Indian companies. In fact, an Indian AIF investing in companies outside of India requires regulatory approval, and there is a limit to how much you can invest in companies outside India. Very importantly, there is pass-through taxation for AIFs, which means that the fund doesn't incur any tax, only the investors directly incur tax. So there is no double taxation. So they don't pay tax once from the fund and then again from their own pockets. They pay tax only once from their own pockets. And this was actually a huge bone of contention. This regulation only came in force in 2013. Before that, there was actually taxation at the fund level. And the decisions of the fund are all delegated to the fund manager, which is the other entity here. Couple of points about the fund manager also. This is actually the entity that takes all the decisions in the fund. It is owned and controlled by the GPs of the fund. This is the entity that hires and manages all the employees in the fund. So most of you will be employees of the fund manager entity, fund manager company, not of the fund. This entity bears all the cost, and the revenue is the management fee that the LPs pay to the fund manager. This is the entity that takes all investment decisions, all follow-on decisions, and all exit decisions. And usually, but not always, this is the entity that receives the carry when investments are sold. This is too simple, so I do want to introduce one very small other entity here, which at least we at Stellaris have incorporated. Not all funds have this entity, which is an overseas pooling vehicle. So for foreign investments, we don't have foreign LPs come directly into the fund. We have a vehicle in Mauritius where they invest, and then that vehicle in turn invests in the fund. There is no tax benefit of having this pooling entity anymore. There used to be before 2017, but now there isn't. But it is still beneficial to have this entity because foreign investors have to deal with less red tape of Indian regulatory authorities. And so it still makes sense to pool their investments in one company and then make that investment into the fund, as opposed to each LP individually investing in the fund. So I'll take a pause here. Would love to hear from Anand as well on the structure and then take questions on the structure. Anything to add, Anand?
No, Ritesh, this is fine. I think we probably should give them an exercise of modeling a fund so that they get an idea of how many unicorns a fund will need, for example, and how much average IRR, because you know the fund has to carve out some money for the fees, etc. So just one spreadsheet, if they can model on their own, it would be great.
Actually, it's an excellent idea. So maybe if we just go back. So
this one itself, yeah.
Yeah, it'll be great if you can create this a model of the simple waterfall, which is and take a $100 million fund, for example.
And 8% hurdle.
10% le lo. India mein 10% hota hai mostly. So 10% hurdle. Make some assumptions on what is the average duration of holding, how many portfolio entities return any money, and what is the average return.
Yeah.
To be able to see how much do LPs make. Basically, the end result should be how much do LPs make and how much does the fund manager make.
Yeah.
And when do those cash flows happen?
Yeah, in this 3x fund, what is the IRR depending on your assumptions of cash coming in and going out? People should take a stab at it, and then we can probably send everybody a sheet. You know, if people submit a good sheet, we can circulate to everybody.
Are you guys okay doing some homework?
You've given one homework already, so earlier. But I think it'll be good to do because unless you model this, the whole problem of creating a fund level return is not understood well.
Yeah.
Unless you model fully.
Does that sound good, guys?
Okay.
Anyone?
Yeah, this sounds okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Great. Fantastic. I have no further slides or material. Perfect. Would love to take any questions on any topic, if you'd like.